Following the opening of the colloquium with the address of the Holy Father Francis and other presentations, I would like to bid you a warm welcome to the afternoon session. This afternoon's presentation encompasses the full breadth of the theme of this colloquium. The first section will demonstrate that the family, based on the foundation of marriage between husband and wife, represents the basic cell of human society. In the reciprocal relationship between wife and husband, we encounter the primal form of that solidarity, which is of fundamental significance for social life. This primal solidarity between woman and man corresponds totally with the order of God's creation, as testified in sacred scripture. There is a recorded that God himself draw the salutary conclusion that is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a suitable partner for him. In this sensitive and sympathetic insight that man in God's sight was not created to be single, we find the basis for the fact that God created Eve for Adam in paradise, indeed as that suitable partner for him. When Adam recognized Eve, who had been fashioned by God, he confirmed God's consoling decision and shouted with joy, "This one at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of her man his one has been taken." That is why a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and the two of them become one body. In the biblical view, wife and husband are the two poles of the ellipse of humanity who complement one another most clearly and beautifully and enrich their life's therapy. They enrich one another precisely because they are different from one another, but equal in dignity. This primal solidarity between man and woman in the history of humanity is quite rightly seen as the training ground for credible solidarity as a whole, neither compelling the unity between human beings into a totalitarian uniformity, nor dissolving the multiplicity of human beings into a disconnected pluralism. Rather, authentic solidarity loves colored diversity and seeks precisely in it in a unity of equal dignity between the sexes. This foundational view of the relationship between woman and man is further intensified in the biblical message in the priestly record of creation, where a theological definition of the nature of mankind is given in the statement, "God created man in his image. In the divine image he created him. Male and female he created them." Man and woman are God's image in the word precisely in the fact that they are different and equal in dignity. If we take seriously this beautiful message of mankind as being the image of God, then there is no such thing as human being. Human beings exist as man and woman. The sexual differentiation in humanity is part of the determination of creation, and woman and man together represent the image of God in the world, as the nucleus of the family, and therewith as the basic form of human society. This is taken so seriously in sacred scripture that the relationship between husband and wife becomes a symbol for the covenant between God and mankind and an image of his love and faithfulness. The bond between wife and husband is the visible representation of that marriage which God celebrates with the whole of humanity and the whole of creation. It is, as it were, the alphabet according to creation, with which the love and faithfulness of God is able to be translated into a language comprehensible to mankind. Already in the Old Testament, we find the faithfulness between husband and wife as an image of God's faithfulness to his covenant And in the New Testament, this is taken further to be boundless love of Christ toward his church. Therefore, it is hardly surprising that the creation reality of marriage has been elevated to the rank of a sacrament in Christian faith, which will form the subject of the second part of this afternoon proceedings. In the light of faith, marriage and the family are sanctified primarily and above all in the fact that Christ, the only begotten Son of God, became man not simply in an abstract sense, but in a very concrete manner, namely as a child in a human family. The Son of God wanted to become man so concretely that he wished to be born into and grow up in a human family. Since belonging to a human family is such a basic element of God becoming man, the Holy Family has become the prototype of the human family as a whole. With this profound view of the relationship of husband and wife as the basis of the family, the Christian faith does not at all intend to claim that marriage and the family are exclusively Christian realities and consequently only able to be realized in faith. The Christian faith instead proceeds on the basis that they in the first instance form part of God's order of creation and represent primal institution of humanity. The Christian faith is therefore also convinced that the future of the family of humanity in a fundamental manner revolves around the family, and the question of marriage and the family is ultimately the question of mankind itself. For the attitude towards marriage and family reveals how human beings understand themselves. Because engagement for the protection of the dignity of mankind demands involvement for the dignity of the family, Christian faith also seeks ecumenical dialogue and interreligious conversation. In fact, in the conviction that the various churches and religions can learn from one another. That in ecumenical dialogue, one encounters not only differences with regard to questions of humanity, such as marriage and family, but in fact finds also fundamental consensus, has been revealed above all in ecumenical collaboration between the Catholic Church and the Orthodox churches. I could mention, for example, the first European Catholic Orthodox Forum with the theme The Family, a Good for Humanity in 2008 in Trent, and the symposium Orthodox and Catholics Together for the Family, organized in 2013 in Rome by the Department for External Affairs of the Orthodox Patriarchate of Moscow and the Pontifical Council for the Family and the Pontifical Council for Promotion of Christian Unity. Such initiatives are to be fostered since in today's society, marriage and the family can only shine in today's society when the gospel of the family is professed in ecumenical collaboration. The same is true of interreligious dialogue. I will of course limit myself to one reference, to the dialogue with Judaism for which I am responsible and from which we can learn much. For Judaism is a religion that in the first instance lived in the family. This is very clear in the celebration of the Shabbat, which begins on Friday evening in the family and continues on the Sabbat in the synagogue. I'm convinced that Judaism owes its continued existence also and especially in the tragic phases of its history, not least to the fact that is deeply anchored in the human realities of marriage and the family. The fact that questions of marriage and the family are being dealt with in this colloquium in an ecumenical and interreligious perspective is therefore very welcome. I regret that I'm only be able to be present today because our Pontifical Council for Promotion of Christian Unity will form tomorrow, be conducting its plenary assembly. I request your understanding for this problem of timing and wish the International Interreligious Colloquium a fruitful continuation and successful outcome. It is now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jan Halland Madlari, former Secretary of State of Norway, for her presentation on the important theme, The Family, Still the Basic Unit of Society. La dottoressa Jan Halland Madlari è professoressa di scienze politiche. È stata segretario di Stato nella Norvegia da 1997 fino a 2000 e ha aiutato vari uffici internazionali e nazionali, tra cui consigliere per la politica estera del principe del Liechtenstein, membro del Consiglio internazionale della scuola MBA Jese di Barcellona, membro del Comitato di Politica della Difesa e membro del Comitato per la Reputazione del Ministero. La dottoressa Madlari è membro del Pontificio Consiglio della Giustizia e della Pace e della Pontificia Accademia delle Scienze Sociali e anche consultore del Pontificio Consiglio per la Famiglia. Lei e suo marito, anche qui presente, hanno 4 figli. Benvenuto, dottoressa Madlari. Grazie.